2, 1, go ahead.
Well, hello everybody. Nice to be with you again. Cannot believe it that it's only been a month. And God is so good and he's so good. Let us pray and ask for the Holy Spirit to lead us and help us. Lord, we love you, Lord. We thank you once more time for this opportunity to be together, to talk about you, Lord, to talk about what you're doing. Oh, Lord, just to be in touch, you know, to remind us that you are Lord and that you are the one who is setting everything for us so we can walk the deeds that you already have prepared, Lord. Lord, I bless my brothers and sisters. I ask you to send your Holy Spirit to all of us. Open our minds, our hearts. Let us understand more and more about you, about your word, and about what you want us to do. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, here we are. I cannot believe that it's our fourth and last meeting. I'm going to miss you guys. So, session one, just kind of reviewing, we talk about how transformation principles and paradigms can be applied and find answers. On our session two, we describe step-by-step what we're doing in Mexico, the prototype that we're implementing. And last session, we talk about building an initiative of your own and giving you some insights and hints and prompting so you can start or continue doing what you're doing. Well, today we're going to talk, it's a very simple but difficult subject, which is problems and challenges and their solutions. What do we have to face as we go and apply and obey the Lord to be transformers, to transform our cities, our nations, our areas of influences? So let's start with a quick review of last session because everything is linked. And we talk about, as I said, the step-by-step process that we need to be led by the Holy Spirit. There's no other way we're going to do it. And of course, build our own initiative based on God's leading. So we said, and I always have this in mind, it starts with faith, it continues with faith, and never ends without faith. It's all about faith. The just shall live by faith. So we said that how do we do it? We approach the nation, or we said we can change the word nation for area of influence. And then how do we do it? Well, remember we talk about Psalms 2:8. We have to ask the Lord in order to do that. How we ask him about the nation. And it is linked to the fact that everything that we're doing are the leaves or part of the leaves of the tree of life to heal the nations. In that context, it's all about love. And as I said, this is what has helped me, and this is what I'm suggesting to start to discern and define the wounds of the nations in your area of influence, or maybe in the city, or maybe, I don't know, maybe the nation, the Holy Spirit, the one who leads. And in order to do that, maybe some of the questions we need to ask ourselves is, what is not right? What needs to be changed? Is there any injustice? And just to kind of explore it, and we talk about that, making start with that, but not with the solution. If we start with solution, we get all messed up and decide not to do anything. So let's stick with what the solution, what the problem is. And then start in your area of influence that you know where, that you are aware of. Because as we are being walking with the Lord, all of a sudden, we find out that we have other areas of influence that we were not aware of, but God is going to bring that to you sooner or later as you start walking or as you continue walking, serving God in the area that he has assigned you. And then we talk that once we do that, we pray and study about the wound. We cannot get involved. We don't know anything about it. And as I said, you need to think about it, pray about it, and study the whole thing, talk to people about it, and say, and what I have experienced is that something happens in my heart, in my mind, things start developing. I become somehow involved and praying about it, and God start giving you some ideas, and that's a good way to start. And then, as I said, you have to own it. You have to make it your problem. How can I serve God to do something about this wound? And, of course, go back always to the Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit inspire you and reveal his will. And then, as I said, once that's done, we have to do it in His time, according to His will. So we don't make things happen. We work, we pray, and we wait for the Lord to give us the right moment and bring the right people. And all of a sudden, we're in the middle of the whole thing. Okay, so let's start section four. We're talking about the objective of this section is how to deal with the problems and challenges that we get as we go forward and try to accomplish the amazing work of transformation. Well, the way I'm going to present it to you is that we're not going to talk about solving the problems or the challenges, but understanding the principles of the solutions. Because I cannot give you solutions to any problem because I don't know what the problems are. We are the ones who face them. But there are some principles that help us to get into that specific problem and then find answers. And I'm going to share what I have experienced, what I have learned, and what it has worked for me that helps me that when the problems arrive, when the challenges rise up, this is the way I process in order to solve them. So I'm going to make a list of five problems and challenges that I have faced, and I'm going to mention the five of them, and then I'm going to go one by one. Are there only five problems and challenges? No, there are about 1,000. But these are the ones that I feel that that I have to hassle with. And in my experience, when as I hassle with these ones and find the principles and start working on them, the other ones become lighter. And at the end, everything works out because it's God's willing. It's God's doing. It's not mine. So the first one is losing our love about what we're doing and why we're doing it. The second one is unbelief. That's a big problem. You have to continue believing. The other one is the lack of faith. I kind of differentiate believing and having faith as two different things. I'm going to explain that later. And then fourth, lack of creativity. Sometimes you're there and you said, oh, we need to do something, but I don't have any clue, any idea. What do we need to do? And the last one is the lack of resources. That's where the rubber hits the road, right? You say, okay, where am I going to get that money that we need to do this? So let's start with the first one, losing our love. It starts with loving the Lord. If we lose that, if we start doing transformation because it's the right thing to do, because more and more people are doing it, we lost everything. We need to do it because we love God. That's the motive, the main motive. I love God and I do what He does. And that's what is central in my own life. And you're in your life too. We need to read the Word. We need to pray. We need to be in contact with Him. We need to learn more about Him. We need to be more in love with Him. And just a reminder, but this is like a guidepost in my life. Which commandment is the most important of all? That was the question that Jesus was asked. And Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. There's unity. And then immediately He says, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. That's the motivation. That's where we get the strength. That's where we get everything from the adventure of being in love with God and loving Him more and more. And it continues, that love that it starts there, it continues where? Well, I believe that's where the cross comes in. The vertical part is loving God with all that we have. And then the other part is loving the world. And loving the world, I express that as according to the Bible, as the Lord says, the second is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. How can you not love your neighbor and do nothing about it? You have to love it, love him, love the surrounding area, love the area that he has put you in your life. And then, of course, bring the kingdom of God. And that's transformation, but it starts with there. And then the Bible says, your neighbor as yourself. And then the Lord says, there is no greater commandment than these. One commandment, two parts. Because this is plural and commandment is singular. The commandment is love God and your brother. Two elements, but one commandment. We cannot try to even understand one without the other. If we love God, we love our brothers. If we love our brothers, we're loving God. There's no other way to see it. So it makes sense. It's a cohesive commandment. It's not part one and part two, even though it is presented to us and first and second commandment. But at the end, it's just one commandment in two parts. They had to go together. So why do we do this? Why are we doing this? Why does God want us to do this? Well, because that's what God does. God loves. He is love. And that has to be the main motivation. When I'm like right now, we're working with all the little part and bigger parts, what we're doing with the immigration part. And I have to, I just came up with to visit in three cities in the state of Sonora. And three or four days, we went to bed at 2 o'clock in the morning and got up at 6 o'clock in the morning. And you say, why are you doing that? Well, because I love God. And that's what God loves. And we need to go and reach out and talk to people. And we have to drive 3-4 hours to different cities and different places, talking to mayors and talking to city representatives and state representatives. Why? The motivation is not necessarily transformation by itself, but the motivation is that's what God does. And I want to do what God does. I want to be the closer I can to Him and to be the closest in His image I can. So for God so loved the world. Sometimes I need to challenge myself and say, for God so loved the church? No. So God so loved the family, my family? No. The world, in the world, is everything. And how did He do it? Unbelievable. It is an amazing story. This is the gospel. He gave His only begotten Son. Well, if we lose our love, then we lose everything. That's part of my story. When the Lord asked me to leave everything, remember I have shared about that? I was living the pastor's dream, and all of a sudden God said, leave everything. I was getting closer to losing that love and doing everything because it was the right thing to do, because I am a pastor. That's what we pastors do, and that's what we have to do. And you get so much involved in the process of doing it that you start, you know, getting a little bit further away of the main reason of our whole existence and our whole life, to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, strength, and our neighbor. So just a reminder, 1 Corinthians 13, verses 1, 2, and 3, it basically says the following: without love, we are a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. I don't want to be that. Without love, verse 2 says we are nothing. And without love, verse 3 says, we gain nothing. That can hit you, because sometimes we're so busy doing so many things for the Lord. But if we're not doing it because of love, we're not gaining anything, even though it looks like a lot of things are happening. So we have to stick in that. And then that amazing chapter, it ends by saying these words. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. That's the motivation. That's the main thing that we need to be guarding and we need to be protecting. Why do we do this? Because we love God and we love the people. And because God loves the world, then we work in the world to bring His image, His love through us, and then applying the principles of transformation and bringing a holistic approach to healing the wounds of the world. Okay, so the next one, one of the problems and challenges, unbelief. Why do I talk about these things and not about money and administration and government and things like that? Well, because if we don't believe, then what are we doing? Because we can be in love with God, love the people, but what are we believing for? What are we doing in that area? So the question, talking about transformation and doing what we need to do, the question is not if we believe in the project we're doing. The question is, do we believe God's word? It has to go back to God's word. It has to be rooted in God's word. Again, we can be involved in so many things and we love what we do. And then we start talking about believing in the project, and then we want people to believe in the project, whatever we're doing, and we disconnect ourselves to the word of God. So talking about believing, are we asking? Have we asked? And then you're going to say, what do we need to ask? Why do we need to be asking? Ask what? Well, the nations, our area of influence. That's I'm not talking about faith. I'm talking about, do we believe what God says? Why? Because it starts with this part. Ask of me and I will give you the nations. And we talk about taking a little bit of freedom here and taking the nations, the part nations, the word nations, kind of decide and put area of influence. Because sometimes we think about nation and we say, wow, I cannot do that. That's too big. Well, part of the whole idea of a nation, it starts with the area of influence where God has put you. So have you asked your area of influence to the Lord? Because he says he's the one who's asking us, ask me and I will give you. So it starts with that. It starts with love, and then you have to continue by believing this wonderful and amazing God that loves so much that he says, ask me, I will give it to you. So if we don't have that love and belief, then we hit to a wall while we're doing a project, and then sometimes we kind of ask a lot of questions, and then we kind of maybe get a little bit discouraged, and then all of a sudden we leave what we're doing. But when you know that God already have given you the area that you have asked him, there's no way out. And in fact, everything increases and gets more exciting. Okay, so love, first thing, we need to believe God's word. And then, okay, one of the problems would be the lack of faith. Now, it can be lack of faith of many things, but let's talk about lack of faith in the practical way of doing what we're doing. So, again, I had to go back to this principle. It starts with faith. It doesn't start with the project. It starts with faith. Just because we love God, we want to project and be his image and be his hands and feet and his heart. And then we believe what he says in his word. Now we have to come to a place of getting the faith. To start with the faith, continue with it, never ends without faith. So again, it's not having faith in the project, but having faith in what God wants to do in your life. So once you believe, when you have belief, this system that you ask God, then you have to faith to live it. As you go and work in an initiative that God will give you in an area of influence, there's always ups and downs. There's always challenges and all of that. But instead of talking about the particular challenges, I'm talking about the heart that you have to have when you face those challenges. And that's where I go back and I say, wait a minute, why am I here? I'm here because I'm loving God, and this amazing love has given his life to me. He sent his son Jesus because he loved the world so much, and he wants me to love him and my neighbor in the same sense, in the same way. And I believe what he says in his word. Now, give me the faith, Lord. And if I go through different circumstances, give me the faith enough in order to follow through and believe. For me, like one of the experiences, when they were trying to put a price on my life, or they did, and they were sending me messages that they were going to kill me. That's when you have said, is this worth it? I remember when I talked to my wife and I said, what should we do? Should we leave town? I can move to the United States, no problem. Should I do that? Why should I do it? If I stay and they kill me, what's going to happen to you and the children? And you go through all this, but if you get too much into the problem without the principles, then you get lost. And then we went back to, why are we doing this? Because we love God. Well, God loved us so much that he gave his son, and he's our master. If I can do whatever he wants me to do, and if that has to be the case, I'm just going to be doing what he already did for me. And if I die, I'm going to heaven anyway, so what's the problem? So it was the whole process, and that way you can continue doing what you're doing besides whatever comes into your life. So you have the faith to live it. And as I said, it's a process. Did I have the faith to believe all that when it started? My answer is no, I didn't. I was struggling, I was praying. But do I have it now? I can say yes, not because I bought the faith or because I am different than anybody else. It's because God trains you. God trains you to have more faith as he takes you further. And it is the faith that he gives you. He's the author of the faith in us. We just need to stick in and keep on going and moving and moving. And he's amazing. He's always faithful. So to me, Ephesians 2 gives me a lot of insight in talking about not only having faith, but believing God's word. We are his craftsmanship, his workmanship. His, not ours. He created in Christ Jesus, for good works. So he created us for good works. And the amazing thing is that he prepared the good works beforehand. And as I understand, he created this beforehand, before the earth was created. That gives me a lot of faith. That gives me a lot of confidence, because God prepared this when I wasn't even born. So my joy is to walk over this workmanship, over these good works that he already did. It. When you get into that, belief or atmosphere, you just enjoy the ride. You just said, okay, look, I get up in the mornings and I'm praying. And I say, Lord, what works have you prepared for me today that you want me to walk over them, so I don't have to create the works? I don't have to invent the works. I just have to be obedient, sensible to the Holy Spirit, eyes open, and saying, where is that work that God prepared for me before I was born, before the earth was created? And then when you're in, you just enjoy it. You say, wow, this is amazing. This is so exciting to live like that. So that's what helps me when the challenges come. I just know, wait a minute. I don't have to create. And one of the illustrations that I have, I learned from my friend from Hawaii. When we talk about surfing, when you go out into the sea, which I never have done it. So this is what they tell me. You go into the sea, you take your surface board, and you're waiting. You're there in the ocean, and you're waiting. You're just waiting. You're just waiting. And some of them said that they can touch the water, and they kind of trying to feel when is the next wave, the next wave coming? When is it coming? And then as soon as you feel it, as soon as you know it's there, as soon as you see that the water started to move, then you do what you have to do to get a little bit in front of that wave, and then you enjoy the ride. Now, can a surfer create the wave? I mean, he can move the hands and he can do whatever he would try to do, but the wave, he's not going to create any wave. He has to wait until the wave by itself, because God is the one who moves the water. Then you just enjoy it and you just go and do it. So I have learned that, and I'm still trying. When I want to do something and God opens that door, I immediately sometimes think that it's going to happen right away. But God, he says he opens the door, he talks about the wave. Now you have to be there waiting and waiting, be sensible to the Spirit. And then all of a sudden, a little bit thing happening here, another here. And then you have to paddle and get into the wave. And then you come up to end up with Ephesians 2:10. Yeah, that's right. We are his workmanship. We are created in Christ Jesus for good works. We don't have to create the works. He already prepared them beforehand. So we should walk in them and, of course, enjoy them. That's when we can say it was God. We were there waiting. We paddled to get the wave, but it was his wave, the one that we were riding, not ours. So next lack of creativity. When you move by love, you believe God's word, you have faith for what you're doing in God, and all of a sudden you get into the problem, you're talking about the wound, you see people hurting and people, you know, suffering, and then you said, I know that we need to do something, but what are we gonna do? And sometimes you kind of feel you run out of ideas, you wanna solve the problems of the world or maybe of your area of influence, and you say, I don't know where to start. Well, that can be a challenge, that can be a problem. So I cannot give you creativity, I cannot tell you what you need to do is this and that. Only the Holy Spirit can do that. So how do you do it? How do you approach the creativity to know to do that? Well, understand that the leaves of the tree of life are to heal the nations. That is God's responsibility. He's the one who feels more the pain of the people. He knows exactly what's going on, and he should be, and he is the inspiration of what we're doing. So it's about the leaves. I can share in my own life how God has all these projects that you can call them, or transform nature in areas that God has been providing in my life, has been with that sense to heal the wounds, to do that. And I can tell you as some of the lessons I have learned, because sometimes God gives you the insight and he gives you the idea. And then you say, oh, I have this idea. You have to go and check it if it's from the Holy Spirit or not. But once it is, then you start working on it. And then you need another idea. You need to be creative. You need to find out what's next. So what I have understand, and I'm in the process of learning even more, is that whatever you're doing, that whatever God is calling you to do, it is greater than you. It is greater than us. And in that sense, the creativity is in others. Mm-hmm. I have learned and I have enjoyed so much that if God gives you a responsibility, he's going to give you enough for you to be walking. But you need other people. You need people to pray for you. You need people to talk to, and you need to listen to them to talk to you. Because as you start working as in a team, then ideas and more ideas are coming up, because the Holy Spirit, that's what he does. And that's where the whole purpose of the body comes in. You know, the body has different parts, and each one does its own. If God tells you to do something in transformation, being the eye, well, you're never going to do what the hand can do. So you need the hand. Where is the hand? Well, that's where the creativity comes from. Of course, you can, as you read, as you learn, as you talk to other people, what are they doing in other areas in the world? What experiences have people have having? All those help things help to prompt ideas, and then you have to process the idea and see if you can implement it in what God wants you to do. Now, in order to have the creativity of others to do what God wants us to do, we need to be humble. We need to ask questions. We need to listen. Even though if you're the leader or the person that God is put in the driving seat, it's just because he wants to, not because you have everything that you need. You have to have other people in the car, and you have to listen to them. And then that's why what would you say, qualities or requirements, is that we need to be humble. We need to understand that we don't have all the answers. People are praying with us, and we're praying with them. And when we don't know what to do, or we need some ideas, say, hey, guys, should we do this? How can we get $1 million? How can we talk to the mayor? How can we do this? How can we do that? And then God started working out. As we started working with this project talking about the immigration and all that, and the farm workers and all that, God just opened one door because of some other people talking to other people. A door was opened with Sammy Rodriguez. Sammy Rodriguez is the pastor that leads an organization of Hispanic congregations. I believe there's about 40,000 in the United States. He was actually the first Latin pastor that had prayed over an inauguration of a presidency in the United States. So God opens that door. God talks to Sammy. Sammy's willing to receive him in the in his office, and then Ed comes, calls me and said, "Hey, Poncho, let's go and talk to Sammy." We go and talk to Sammy, talk about what we're trying to do, the all this is all about. He started talking about his some of his feelings about that and all that. He said, "This is great." And now the whole project is in the desk of the Vice President of the United States, of Mike Pence. If I would have thought, hey, we need to go to the president, I wouldn't have any idea. But talk to Ed, pray about it. Somebody talk to Sammy. Ed contacts Sammy, and then Sammy receives us, and now this is happening. So it is amazing. As I said, it goes back to God so much loved the world. He wants us to believe his word. He already wrote that. It's about him. It's about love. And then we have the faith. We start doing it. Now we're talking about creativity. Well, because he ordained the words, and we're just walking over them. He has everything under control. We just need to be patient, praying. And as I said, talk to people, talk to other people, and pray about it. Pray for them. Get him involved. Get you involved in what they're doing. Own it. And all of a sudden, you find out that there's a wealth of ideas and creativity by the Holy Spirit to his body, the body of Jesus Christ. That's why when we go to conferences, when you come to a conference, don't just think that you're coming to learn. You're coming also to give, because for sure you're doing something that somebody needs to hear about, and vice versa. So to me, conferences are like going to a pool, a deep pool, like getting to this huge amount of water and just enjoying ourselves, splashing water one over the other, sharing experiences, creativity. I mean, what God's doing when somebody gets in front and he starts sharing what God is doing in their life, whatever part of the world. I mean, I'm just going like, yeah, this is the body of Christ. This is the ecclesia. This is what God is doing. And it is amazing. But remember, you need to be humble. You need to listen. You need to be open. So, again, it is greater than us. Build your team. Work with that team. Don't feel that you have to do it all. Don't never think that you know everything. It's about teamwork. It's about the body. It's about working together under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And we do it in order. We have order. We have leaders. We have people to submit to. And we have responsibilities. But we do it in love. We do it because we love God. We love each other. We love the people we try to reach. So that's what helped me a lot. Now, don't lose your faith. Believe the word of God. Have faith in what you're doing, because that's what God wants you to do. Don't limit yourself. Include others. And the last one that I would like to talk is the lack of resources. I put this at the end because sometimes we try to put this at the beginning. You feel something from God and you say, okay, let's do this. Let's change. Let's transform this area of the city. And then if the next question is, how much money are we going to get? I think we started with the wrong question, because usually it takes a lot of money. And if you start like that and you look into your pockets and you say, well, I have $5. How much can that help? But if you go through the process, so it is about love. It is about believing God's word. It's about believing in him and what he wants you to do. It's about the body of Christ, the ecclesia, working together. Then you find out another amazing thing. He's the one who provides the money. And in that sense, we have to understand the what. This has helped me a lot. You have to understand what God wants you to do, what God wants you to be involved. The other part, that part is our responsibility. We need to pray. We need to work. We need to study. We need to talk to people about the wounds and all that. That's our responsibility. That's not going to just happen. God is going to prompt us. The Holy Spirit is going to lead us, but we have to invest the time to do that. Well, that's the what. But who defines the how? Who says, how are we going to do it? Well, that's the Holy Spirit's responsibility. That's his area. So to me, when I understand the what, and I have love, the love from God, faith, I believe God's word, I'm working with people, then the Holy Spirit is the one who gives me the how. The Holy Spirit is the one who opens the door, closes the door. He's the one who does everything. Right now, I can tell you that I have so many questions about house. because you're talking a lot of money. Just to give you an idea, for us to bring a worker, a farm worker from Chiapas. Chiapas is in the southern part of the Mexican Republic, almost at the border with Guatemala, South America. And in order to get a worker from there to here, we need to spend about $500 to $600 per person. Now, we're doing this by faith, and we, as a nonprofit organization, we're not charging them any money to pay for what we need to do. We need to pay for the medical exam, because there are requirements. If you have tuberculosis, you're not going to go into the United States to work. They're not going to give you a visa. You have to have a letter that says that you don't have any criminal record. You have to get your Mexican passport, which is about $80-$85. Then you need to get to come to Juarez to the consulate, and you have to take a bus or a flight or whatever, however you want. You need to come, get to Juarez, spend 2 or 3 days, rent a place to sleep, eat for 2 or 3 days while the process in the U.S. consulate is done. And then you had to, once all that is ready, then you had to pay for the immigration visa, which is about $200, $220 or something like that. So you take the $200, transportation, meals, the Mexican passport, medical exam, this letter, it's around $500. It can be six, depending how far are you from the border. Well, we're working right now to bring 1,000 of them from the area of Chiapas in Oaxaca. The area of Chiapas in Oaxaca was the epicenter of the earthquake that we had in Mexico. A lot of people are without homes. I just went there, and you're driving in the streets, and you see people still bringing down the pieces of brick and everything, because their houses just collapsed. And we're talking thousands of houses, and I'm not kidding you. We drove around the city, every block there were houses in the totally destroyed. I went there. This is about 4 or 5 months ago, and the kids are still in buckets, taking the bricks outside of the and putting them in the street. The government is picking all that trash, and some of them already started bringing some bricks in order to rebuild their homes. So we decided to get into the area because that's where the need is. Well, if we're talking about 1,000 workers, 500 per person, we're talking about $500,000.
Yep.
And you say, do I have the money? Of course not. But talking to people, as I said, asking questions, we met a lady that knows a huge attorney's firm, a law firm in the United States, and these people have a heart for what is happening, and they're paying for these 1,000 people to come to the border and do that.
Wow.
So now that's the first 1,000. We need about 100,000. 100,000 times $500, you do the math, 500 million. That's a how. I don't worry much about it, because that's the Holy Spirit responsibility. And yeah, talking to people, I found out. I talked to the president of a national bank in Mexico, and this guy says, I'm willing to lend the $200 to the people who are going to work there, so they can pay me $5 a week, and they can pay me back. So God is, the Holy Spirit is developing that. In the meantime, we're signing a contract with Georgia, with the farmers and the government and the Department of Labor and Department of Agriculture. And we're signing a contract where we're going to provide all these workers to take them over there. I have a lot of questions on how many houses, especially resources. But that's not my problem. My challenge is to believe, which I have. And I believe because I believed before and before and before and before. And everything started believing this. Just a small step, small beginning. But through all these years, God has increased our faith by His grace. And now I don't know where the money is going to come, but it's going to come. Because I believe. because I have faith in God, because he loves the world so much, and he's not doing this for me. I'm not doing this for me. We're doing it because God so much loves the world. So it's the Holy Spirit's responsibility. And it's a model that you can see in the Bible. Talk about Moses. The Lord speaks to him, and he says, go to talk to Pharaoh and tell him to leave my people go. If somebody would know that Pharaoh was going to let the people go, it was Moses. He was born there. He was there. Pharaoh needed the people to build his dream city. But when the Lord talks to Moses, the Lord tells Moses, I want you to go and tell him to let my people go. That was the how. That was the what, I'm sorry. That was the what. When Moses started thinking about the how, he said, with me? I don't even have the answer of some of the questions I have to answer because I don't speak well. And he disqualified himself because he was thinking on himself. He wasn't thinking of the how, which is the Holy Spirit responsibility. But then the Lord asked him, what do you have in your hand? And I guess that Moses kind of turned around, in my hand. What do you mean in my hand? I only have my rod. And I have heard some people talk about the rod, and they turn out the rod to become a spiritual something that is, you know, I don't know what. To me, the rod is an instrument of work. That's why he had a rod in his hand. So if I talk it to a carpenter and God wants him to do that, the Lord's going to ask him, what do you have in your hands? And he says, hammer. Well, if you allow me to use that hammer, put the hammer in the floor, it's going to become a serpent. With that hammer, you're going to stick a rock, it's going to come water out of it. And you're going to use that hammer and put in the water, and the sea is going to part in two. It's who you are. That's why when Ed teaches us that work is worship, I'm so much convinced, because whatever we use as instrument for our work, whatever we do, even if moms are working in the home, whatever they do, is that's what God wants to use. So the how was given to Moses as he believed, as he walked in faith. And all of a sudden, they needed meat. The doves started coming from all over the place. They needed bread. The manna came from heaven. I mean, it was and think about it. That's the way all these amazing men and women of God has done it. Noah, the what was build an ark, the how, the wood and the measurements, and then getting the animals inside of this huge ship. He didn't care. He just was obedient and did what he did. All of a sudden, each animal in the each species by two and two, they came into the ark. Only God can do that. That's the Holy Spirit's responsibility. So when I'm in a situation like this, and you talk about resources, and of course we're not naive. We do the numbers. We have everything kind of planned and under control. But the provision, it has to come from God. When we started the museum, our project was $1 million. It was a nice small museum because that was we had faith for. By the end of 9 years, we ended up with a $32 million museum. Right now, it's the second largest in Mexico. I didn't have any clue. I didn't have the faith. But I knew the what, and I stick to the what. God provided the how, the resources. So this is some of the of the way we have embraced and try to solve all these problems and challenges. I didn't want to talk about specifics because the challenges that you're going to have or you already have are different than mine, is that different than everybody, but the principles are the same. So I hope this builds your faith, builds your trust in the Lord. Stick with the most important thing: love, believe, faith, and then the body of Christ, the ecclesia, and then God will provide everything else. So any questions, anything that you would like to ask, we open this part. So let's see what. So anybody has a question or maybe something to share?
Well, I'll share something that just happened today, Poncho.
Yes.
I think you know that we do prison ministry. Gail and I both do. And our prison ministry is Transformation Prison Ministry. So I've been sharing the DVDs and I've been sharing what the program I've been going through with all of us here about the, you know, dignity for the legal farm workers. These guys in prison, they just can't fathom this, you know, that, you know, they're doing this, you know, and yes. Anytime that it comes up, you know, well, how much these guys get paid and stuff? I said, no, they're just doing this. They just can't believe it. But we had a kind of a unique situation. We've got a guy that was in the county where we do our prison work, has finally been sentenced, and he's going to be going to state time. And so I had told him as soon as we found that out, I said, well, I'm going to commission you as an ambassador because you're going to be our representative for transformation to the prison as you go forth. And so we presented him with that certificate, and he's been leading on his own, not in mine, but on his own inside the pod where he lives. He's been leading a daily Bible study. And so he had all those guys come in, and we all got around him, and he kneeled down so I could lay hands on him, pray for him, and give him the certificate as an ambassador going forward as a commission to be an agent of transformation.
Yes.
And it's exactly what you're doing here. You're commissioning these guys, and then you're using all of these folks that are going to be coming in and being these supervisors, and it's going to be just multiplication of transformation, and it's awesome.
Yes, it is.
Well, we started with one. You started with one, and you know, yeah, what's 100,000? It's just a bunch more zeros.
We're gonna see that by God's grace.
Amen.
Okay. Anybody else? If not, what we can do is I would like to pray and to impart. But anybody wants to share anything? If not, let's pray. And I would like to impart basically the principles.
And I'd like to know, can we use your slides?
You can use them anytime, any place you want them. It's the Lord gave us to us free, and we give it away free. Yes, feel free to do it. No doubt about that.
Amen.
I have several groups I'd like to show them to.
Yes. Yes. Okay, so let's pray. Lord, we thank you. Oh, you're an amazing and powerful God. And even though you have all these amazing dreams for us, you take us always by the hand. You lead us step by step. You're always with us. Sometimes we stumble, Lord. Sometimes we doubt. Sometimes we have challenges and problems, but you are always there. And for us, Lord, to know that you love us so much and you teach us to do the same. Your word is perfect, Lord, and we can stick to that word and trust you. We can use the faith that you have given us to walk everything that you are teaching us. And then, Lord, we can do this with amazing people, with the ecclesia, with brothers and sisters, not only the ones we know when we have very close to us, but even the people far away, that you link our hearts, and we know that we're in this together. And Lord, you are the one who provides everything. You are the provider. Everything belongs to you, and you are eager, Lord, to give that away in order to accomplish your goal and your purpose. Lord, in your name, I impart, Lord, right now to everybody who's listening, the anointing, Lord, the sensibility to learn and understand what you want us to do, trust in you, be more in love with you. So, Lord, that this anointing will carry on. And as I receive from so many others the anointing that you have given them, now, Lord, I give it back on what you have given us in Juarez, in my own life. So in Jesus' name, receive it, and may the Lord do amazing things in your life as he does it with all of us, ordinary people doing extraordinary works. Why? Because we serve an amazing and extraordinary God, the only God in the whole universe. So in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
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 Well, I have one other thing I could share with the group, Poncho.
Yes.
They may not be aware that you and Ed came, you know, when we had the 10,000 men event that we had promoted, and you and Ed came. And the reason you got invited is because we originally had Sam Rodriguez was to come. And at the last moment, he said he couldn't. And I said, I have the perfect guy to bring in his place. And that was you. And, you know, how does God do this? Now you're going to be working with Sam.
Yeah.
You know, that's how God does things. We can't figure it out. Just like you said, you know, it's the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And he wants to do it with his family. And we are in the family.
Yep. We can't do it without him, as Ed says. But for some reason, he doesn't want to do it without us.
Yes. And I'm enjoying it so much.
Enjoy the ride.
Yes. Let's take the wave.
Amen. Amen.
Okay. God bless everybody.
Okay. Thank you.
Good.